Okay, so hi everybody again, I'm Jacob Feldman, and today our next monthly session of DecisionCAMP, as we decided to do it almost every month. So today I will talk about use of machine learning inside decision modeling systems. And as you're well aware, machine learning, one of the most popular topic today, dominating everything and is actually associated with the word AI. But for very practical reasons, we people who work in with decision models, with decision services, we really see a need for practical machine learning algorithms available to business analysts. To people without special background in decision data science or statistics. And I personally started to work with machine learning back in 2006. And we did several big projects, in particular in IRS, when we need to find business rules from large collections of historical data. And that's what one of the most typical use of rules and the most attractive use case for us. And recently we announced, we took our rule owner available for 14 years now and put it in open source. It's available on the ruleowner.com, and it actually can be incorporated in any decisioning platform today. And I will show you how it works, and we can hopefully have a productive discussion. So, rule owner, as I said, oriented to business analysts who want to apply machine learning to their historical data and get business rules without necessity to learn complex data format, new interfaces, or sometimes even programming. So, how it works? This is a general schema, and on this schema, we just ask business people to create two Excel table. One table we call training instances with specific training instances. Another table, it's our typical glossary, what we usually use inside decision models. And this glossary describes different training attributes specific for this particular problem. And then we allow business analysts select from a variety of machine learning algorithms. Our two major algorithms are Reaper and C4.5. And when it's applied, we automatically generate rules in a friendly format that could be understandable, and that could business people could understand, and also rule engine can execute them. Optionally, we allow people to create so-called training rules to filter or to adjust training instances and then feed them to rule owner. I will talk about this later. So if we, to summarize how it works, it's quite natural. What business analyst is supposed to do? Create two Excel tables for, with training instances and with in glossary that describes attributes, then select one of the possible algorithms and just click learn BAT and rules and different quality metrics will be automatically generated. And to instead of talk about this, let's look on particular example. So I do in this example, I have, so in this example we call credit classification rules. When we have credit data and it has 1000 records with different, about different credit, that's credit records about different debtors, and there are various attributes like checking status, duration, credit history, purpose, and many, many others. And each record out of this 1,000, because this is training records, they already classified as good or bad. And what we want to do, we want to find such rules that are capable to classify new records. And let me just jump and show you real data instead of going here. So this is my, this is rule owner. When you download rule owner, you will find a lot of examples. This is credits. And inside credit, I have a table credits. I think I already opened this. This is my table. And my instances, this is my instances. You can see there are a lot of, that's 1,000 instances, and this is different attributes. So I put this in regular data table, we call this decision data, and just list attributes, their titles and the different values. And the last attribute here is attribute classified as good or bad. And there are plenty of different records, so it's quite serious data set, training set. And but also what we should do, we create glossary. And this is our typical glossary. It has name of different decision variables here. They the same as title in instance tables. They all belong to one business concept. We call it training instance. They have, this is the technical names of these attributes for integration with IT system. These attributes could have different types. It could be nominal string attributes or integer or double or boolean. And this is possible domains of this variables, so you can list them as you wish. So this is quite natural, and usually all our customers, like for all other, for your products, they always create some kind of glossary, right? And so I'm not looking on the filtering rules right now, but that's basically it. And when this business analyst created this table and this table, so now I can just run it. And to run it, I will click clone. Clone BAT. So I'm running right now rule owner with default algorithm. Let's see, I don't remember what is inside. So actually right now, because problem it changes, it rebuilds everything. It's no, if it was not a problem, it changes. It tells you what it is, and it generated all rules already, and it's produced all these rules were generated here, but and it's produced different rules. In this case, we use VECA as underlying algorithm incorporated in this particular implementation of rule owner. And there are some statistic characteristic. You can see that 72.7% created. Let's look on this generated rules. They were generated by default in file generated rules. And I'm just clicking on Excel. And this file, so it's, you can see that it's quite simple format. So basically our rule owner decided to create only four rules, and it selected out of many attributes only these four essential attributes, and decided to classify all records using these four rules. And in all other cases, they will consider that this is a good depth, only three suspicious situation. And it also produces in second tab different characteristics. So people who understand what does it mean, they can look at this. And but one of the things what very interesting is that it's according to applying all things like cross-validation, rule owner decided that this is only 72.7% rules are good. All other things could be incorrectly, in new instances could be incorrectly classified in 27% of cases. But when we look to also rule owner applies the same rules to actual records what we had. And if we classify them, 756 out of 1,000 will be classified correctly. But if I change this algorithm and to rule, let me close this, and I will change algorithm in this particular case, because I'm running not from graphical interface, but from a regular Windows Explorer, I can just make change in this file and learning classifier. We can have multiple classifier. I will make it C4.5. I will save it. And when I run it again, it applies different algorithm. And as you probably, if you tried different algorithm, you know that they all produce different results. And we selected after years of using, we experimented with more than 20 different algorithms. Reaper usually produces the most compact rules, and C4.5 produces much larger set of rules because it usually it produces this decision tree. If you look on the results, so this is quite big decision tree here, but we represent, we take this tree and we represent this in Excel format. So let's look on the generated rules. So you can see all these huge generated rules. It's quite big. So it actually has 103 rules and with different characteristics. So now we can see all these rules and all records, and we also can see, because it's inside decision model, we can see all explanations with why certain records were classified correctly and some of them were not classified, were classified incorrectly. So if you were here, so it shows all instances and how they were classified correctly or incorrectly, and we can have all these nice features provided by generic system. But if I go back to my slides, I want to concentrate on something more important. Everybody can generate these things, but what is really important, when we generated Reaper rules, four rules, this only four rules, and they correctly classified 756 instances out of 1,000. And if, when we applied the cross-validation, it gives us a 72.7% success rate. And if we, when we go to C4.5 algorithms, so it's a Quinn plan, it generates, it correctly classifies 855. Which case is better? It's really difficult to judge, but it's not very convenient to work with so many rules, like we have 103 rules versus four rules. But I would not dare to judge them. Maybe it still gives business people very interesting opportunities to use more rules here and add their own, adjust these rules as they go. But what is interesting is that while training, it's much better for training classification, but when we applied cross-validation, you can see it's less, success rate is less than produced by Reaper. In general, I want to, when you look on this, so you understand now I can go through huge, we tried this on much, much larger examples. Speed is great, but quality of rules always a little bit suspicious. So now it's the most important question. How we can talk about quality of rules? And here, that's everybody faces problem. Should we even try to generate perfect rules that guarantee to give the correct classification on all instances in training set? Me, like a lot of other people, answering no, because we would rather generate sensible rules that avoid overfitting the training set and thereby stand a better chance of performing well on new instances. This is a quote from two professors who created, two authors of VECA system. And this is, it was valid 20 years ago and it's still very important today. But still, if I'm, let's say, domain expert, how can I judge, how can I improve my rules? How can I minimize these errors? And our practical use of machine learning for more than 14 years on different projects shows us that the most important thing is really not your knowledge of statistics, but your understanding of domain, of problem domain. And we always involve domain experts to do this rule generation, regeneration, adjustment. And we can see two ways to adjust rules to improve their quality, before generation and after generation. So before generation, we offered our customers so-called rule trainer. And it's a training rule engine that allows customer to introduce their understanding of domain in so-called training rules. And these training rules can usually it filters all training instances, removes outliers, whatever meaning of outlier, it's a business meaning. So usually when we gave this power to business people, they really appreciated this and they started to modify their training sets, split them in several. Actually, they even added new records. For example, they worry about positive and negative proportion between positive and negative samples, and they do experiments all the time. And from this perspective, it's not just machine learning plus business rules. It's also business BR plus ML plus BR. I will show you this in a second. But what is also very important, when rules already generated, after rules generation, we let people to understand them, business people, they analyze them, they actually may interpret them. And this is a very important from real world. I know how important to understand for business people to understand the rules themselves, because as you understand, for machine learning, for example, if you give record number, it means nothing, it's just number. And suddenly when they recognize, for example, in our RS project, when people look that somehow our rule owner selected if record number more than 50,000 or more than something, they immediately interpreted that this was record that was late tax return, for example. And so they have understanding. Statistical methods don't have this understanding. And that's why people always can adjust it better. So it's very important to be in this ever-learning cycle. I will talk about this in a second. But what is more important, how actually system work in the real world. In real world, we have two worlds. We have analytical world and operational world. Think about insurance. Think about when in analytical world they analyzed the enterprise data repository, and they come up usually with rules themselves. But if they want to discover certain rules based on their historical data, they take certain records from historical data from enterprise repository. They write business analysts, write training rules. They run rule trainer. That's basically our rule engine. And this rule engine, as a result, produces training instances to feed them to rule owner. And based on multiple algorithms, they got generated rules. And being in this cycle until they satisfied, business analysts, when they feel comfortable, they tell, okay, now you can use these rules inside your enterprise rule repository. Of course, using version control and all other features, it goes to repository. Then in operational world, people can use these rules, and using these rules, traditional rule engine will produce decisions, and these decisions will be saved, results will be saved here. And if they saved here, they could feed us with new historical data. So whenever in the analyst world, people decide, let me repeat this procedure. It could be done automatically, it could be done manually, but after repeating this procedure, we can generate new set of rules that reflects the latest discoveries. And being in this loop forever, we can consider so-called ever-learning rules. So that's why in general, I called this session self-learning decision models. When we have in this ever-learning decision, digital decisioning system. So we have rule owner here, it feeds our new rules. Rule engine produces new records. These records can feed rule owner, and we convert our rule owner in a good employee of the company who could learn as they go. In a way, it's not artificial intelligence, but in a way, it's a very valuable employee of the company. And self-learning, self-improving system. So this is the essence of my presentation, and I just can tell you from other perspective, because I need to keep this short, that we also putting this, because we want to make it available to business analysts, we put this in AWS Marketplace, where business analysts can create one Excel file, drag and drop this file to our graphical interface, select one of two or three algorithm and click rule owner. It will receive results. It can download these results and use it, or just try again. And until they satisfy, they can do this without any installation. This SaaS rule owner would be available, I expect, next week. We already have working release, but still some work required. And as to let me tell you a few words about implementation. So everything in open source with LGPL, it means no limitations for production environment. And it has extremely simple Java API for integration in any other systems. And the underlying ML algorithms coming from open source Weka, but we also in process to add other implementations and more algorithms here. And it works right now fine with OpenRules Decision Manager. You can get it for free with free evaluation, or you can use SaaS Decision Manager. And it's also what I wanted to tell, it's easy to integrate with other systems. So I know that some vendors here, so if you decide to add rule owner to your system, we would be happy to help you, because in general, we still see a lot of mixed results with using ML and business rules together. So that's my presentation, and I think questions more important than presentation. So let's open questions. Okay. You hear me well, right? Let me unmute everybody, because it's really, if you want to talk, please talk. Let me see where is, and how can I unmute you? Okay, I think you can unmute yourself, but Jan, I can see questions from you. And you can, let me, how can I unmute? Control, participants, unmute all. I will unmute all. We don't have too many people, so please feel free to talk whenever you want. So I can see first question from Jan Jacob. Can you combine these rule sets into ensembles or prune the trees to achieve better generalization, possibly with BI help? Yes, I believe we can. Probably it will require some adjustments, but it should be very simple, because instead of one table, we can have a set of related tables. If I answer your question, Jan, or you want to clarify it? Jan, do you want to clarify your question?
Jacob, thank you, first of all, for a fascinating presentation. Yes, my question is more, if you generate, is it possible to improve the performance that you've demonstrated with individual rule induction algorithms by combining the results of multiple algorithms into an ensemble and then vote?
That's what you mean. Yeah. It's not available right now, but I don't see any problems why not to. So we can actually run many. What you call ensembles, we can run many and automatically compare results. It would require a little bit work, but it's not something, I don't see any showstoppers to do it.
And the second part of that question was, we both know that decision trees and rules that are induced from data tend to overfit.
Yes.
And very often what happens is there's some form of entropy-based pruning to avoid overfitting. Some sort of regularization is applied, which normally means that some leaves of the rule trees are pruned.
Yes.
I was wondering if you had the facility to do this, or maybe had some way that a business analyst could.
Yes. What we do to do this, we have two choices for people who are familiar with different classifiers and their options. for example, for people who read, for example, Weka book. And you can, Weka provides a lot of options for classifiers and a lot of filters. So we have two facilities. Number one, you can apply these options, and we have parameters, options, and the meaning of them really comes from a particular implementation like Weka. For example, Reaper has its own options, and C4.5 has other options and other filters. Not everything is supported. But this is quite difficult. Our experience shows that wherever we played with these options and filters, and we had devoted people very well aware about the meaning of options and results, we could not improve dramatically. But when we involved business analysts and gave them this trainer and facility to introduce training rules, then quality was really improved. And more than that, we never insisted that this is a one done job and it will work. Maybe it will work for a while, but after a while, you need to keep improving. It's not once and done. That's all, you have always put your customer in situation ever learning. That's, I can see it's your second question.
Yeah, my next question is, that's absolutely, I totally agree with that. I wondered how it worked. Is it like continuous online learning where instance by instance the tree is adapted, or is it a kind of batch mode? Every now and then you retrain
I can tell you about two situations. Some of them it was a batch mode when a business analyst selects this historical data and we gave them graphical interface for selection. But for this particular application, it's a quite large system in IRS. But they modify their rules because they know new trends and something new happened and they want to have better selection. And then rule trainer selects from this data new training instances and do it. That's something what you call batch mode. But at the same time, we had the experience when we have rules coming and it was pricing situation when we have to figure out new prices. And in this case, we cannot allow batch mode because it's coming basically, it's at the end of the day, we need to have new prices for next day based on current state of inventory and yesterday sales experience. So this was automated in one always running loop by people who use our services. So that's answer is both. Okay. Any other questions, please? I can see that Bob Moore is here. Okay.
Yeah. One question which I'd like to ask, I think, is really to try and clarify a bit about the rule trainer, because I wasn't quite sure. Are all you doing essentially filtering the instances which are going into
the rule? In simple case, yes. For example, I do have somewhere here article I published here. For this particular example, if you go to LinkedIn, and I demonstrated here this rule trainer. So rule trainer, it was in this particular case, I just did something very simple. I put, rule trainer. No, probably it's in, rule trainer is here. So what I did some filtering, and this filtering, for example, this was my filtering rules. I created here source instances and filtered instances, and my rules, that's my filtering rules. For example, from all people, select only foreign workers, older than 30 years old, 30 years or older. And this is my filtering rules. From this perspective, actually, our customers can create not one huge training set when everything mixed. They can choose what they want, subsets specifically. If they believe it's completely foreign worker and not foreign worker, they completely can have different rules. So they, for example, in real world situation, we had about 12,000 attributes. And if you put them all together, it would be a mess. What they started to do, they classified them for more than 50 different sub-issues. And these issues, they all have their own combination. So they defined rules to how to select this sub-training subsets. And they all, it's not also not something in stone. They keep modifying this and maintain this thing. That's why it's so important that to have this trainer to be present, because that's how people introduce their business understanding of context and their business knowledge, what was not even available maybe 3 months ago. Because new regulations, something changed. What I can tell you, this was one of the, we were quite successful. Even machine learning is not always produces better results, but we managed to produce 2-3% saving. And this is a huge amount to compare with manual rules that we never seen. Nobody knew these rules. But because of rule trainer and ability to constantly improve, that was a key component. So even simple trainer like this could be extremely valuable.
Okay.
Okay. Okay. I can see comment from Denis and Jan, C4.5 and Reaper are infamous for very high variance. That's correct. A slight modification to the training instance can cause large difference. Absolutely. How do you handle this volatility? You know, that's what Jan, actually, it's even, I would support everything what you sell, and I would not, I would tell, I don't have any magic things to handle this volatility, right? And you probably also don't have it, because this is all problems with ML. In spite of all hype, ML still does not understand anything. It just for them, it's everything strings or numbers. So even a famous example when you want to find rules when people can read, and suddenly it finds relationship between shoe size and reading, not with age and reading. And so only human can understand that the shoe size related to to age, for example. And the same thing here, when you just change something in one or two attributes, it can dramatically completely modify the rules. So what we do, we just, what I told you about this training, selecting small pieces, and we allow people, business people, to adjust these rules afterwards. So they can modify only small pieces, and they don't know how to judge them. So it's not like only one set of rules generated. They have many, many sets of rules, and they look on small variants in generated rules, and they still humanly control. Like somebody wrote on the comment, it's you can trust, but you should verify. And this is trust and verify, extremely important concept when you applying machine learning within decision models. And it's really today, guys, please feel free to put more questions, but Denis, I've seen recently announced that Trisatech has something. Jan purchased and with his colleagues introduced this even 2 years ago. They presented this work in 2018 on DecisionCAMP. A lot of people work on this, but I wanted to do with Rule Owner to make everything freely available to promote the integrated use of machine learning and decision models, because they still we're falling behind. And I believe as an industry, decision management should be much more aggressive, providing specific tools to business analysts as always, and not expect them to become great statisticians. And it's not necessary, right? Okay, anybody else? Okay, and I really encourage you to go to this ruleowner.com, download it if you notice something, and if you suggest some improvements, I would be happy to add to our system. As I said, we will have everything available online, so you don't have to install it. But let's say you're a vendor and you want to use similar system, because everything is open source, it doesn't put any additional limitations, we would be happy to help you with this. I think we're all in the same boat, trying to bring additional power to our decisioning platforms. And Bob, I wanted to, I can see, thank you. Bob, I applied this to robots. You can see my solution to robots, what you did before. And one of the funny things what confirms Jan's observation, when we applied one algorithm, it produced expected rules to classify good and bad robots. But then when we applied another algorithm, the generated rule sounded like this: all robots are unfriendly. And it had pretty good statistical characteristics. So that was funny. Okay. So if you don't have questions, thank you very much. We usually try to keep this short, and see you all next time.
Okay, thanks very much.
Bye.
Thanks, Jacob. That was a great presentation.
Thank you, Denis.
Fascinating stuff. Thanks, Jacob. Really appreciate it.
Bye, everybody.
Very interesting, Jacob. Thanks a lot.
You're welcome.